Richard, on the eve of the release of the album, how are you feeling?
Excited, really. Got anticipation for the genuine heads and fans who got into the last album and my last set of songs, because I know it's all there for them to explore and enjoy. I put everything into it, soulful songs, it's heavy music, it's beautiful music. I've got no regrets, you know. It's the first one for me. It's the first set of 13 songs that I've written, put together. I've got my silly name on the front of the sleeve, you know, everything's a first, really. So as a first solo album, I think it's an achievement. It's, you know, I'm not afraid of what people say about it. I just think the genuine people, the people who are coming with their ears open, are going to really enjoy it.
Can I say one word? Don't put your hands in your pockets like that, because it looks like you're rummaging around.
Oh, it looks like I'm rummaging my balls.
Yeah.
Does it?
Just, yeah, I just thought you might watch it back and you might not like that.
Oh, I might think I was doing it. Is that what it looks like, really? All right.
Okay, so this is your first solo stuff, all on your own, and you're totally accountable for the whole thing. Can we just talk briefly about the Verve and what state of mind you were in after the Verve split up?
I was as upset as anyone else that the band didn't continue to make more records. There's still a hell of a lot of potential as them, you know, those four or five musicians together. But relief that I didn't have to go through it anymore. You know, I felt like we'd definitely put a full stop on it. We'd achieved a lot. We'd made a lot of records, many that people haven't even heard yet. I don't know, we'd done so much, but it had been tempered now and again with bad feelings and just the general stuff that surrounds groups, you know. It's very difficult for, you know, to imagine when you're 17 that in 18, when 10 years time, that you're not gonna wanna be in a chrome bus together with all your baggage going through America for 5 weeks. You know each other better than anybody else, so there's no hiding it under the rug, and if you start hiding under the rug, the pile gets so high, it's just ridiculous. You can't see each other, the rug's so high, so you have to make a decision. Often the right decisions are very painful. That's just life, you know what I mean? I think that was I never wanted to make music for money or out of the fear that I needed to have this band or this title. And I think that's the problem that I'll face when the record comes out, is that everybody will be thinking about the Verve. Probably in thinking about the Verve with without any real idea of what we're really about. I don't think anybody knows what went on, and I'm glad about that. I don't want to spill the beans on people that meant a hell of a lot to me. You know, whatever happened, there's no malice with me. There's no need to sell my record on the back of other people. I always find it very distasteful when people do that.
What do you need around you then? What kind of things to create the perfect environment for you to be making good music?
I don't need much, really. I just need a microphone and some amps and someone behind the desk. Someone making milky coffees. Someone getting
milky
the beers.
Coffees, right.
Yeah. Someone getting the beers in. Someone in the back skinning up, and let's just do it. It's easy. It's very, very easy, you know.
I've got money to burn, I wanna burn it on you. Come on, yeah, yeah. We got one short life, I wanna spend it with you. You light my fire, I wanna burn all night, I wanna burn on through. Ah, yeah, yeah. We got one short life, I wanna spend it with you. One last dance, I wanna dance with you. Come on now. We got one last supper, gonna eat with you. Ah, yeah, yeah. We got one last high, I'm gonna get high too. Come on now. We got one short life, I wanna spend with you. one invention. You're my one and only gift I got. Now, baby, it's a real adventure. I'm so glad I met you. You're my one gift I got from above. From above.
People have a difficulty in believing that someone from, some kid from Wigan can pull it off. I think they have a difficulty believing we pulled it off with the Verve. You know, I said it all the time from 92 onwards that we were going to end up selling millions of records.
But people generally support the underdog, if that's how you see yourself.
I don't think they see me as an underdog now because I've got more pounds in the bank. That's simply that.
So you think people resent you wearing good clothes, having your big manor and stuff?
My big manor. Oh, my manor house.
From what I've heard, it's a big manor.
Oh, no, it's not that big at all. I mean, I didn't have that house, it would have gone insane. But,
for what reason?
I think people want, you know, people don't realise that when you have had the experiences I've had and done the things I've done, you always see the world with a correct pair of sunglasses. That's it. Huxley said himself, you take acid once, it changes your perception for the rest of your life. And I'm not just talking about acid, I'm talking about my experiences within the band and music itself. I'll always be slightly cracked, doesn't matter what's happened within my life. I'm only now, and I probably won't be able to fully say that I've got my life totally in order until next year when I stop touring. So I think people have got this concept of, my wife's had a child, I'm married, I'm in a country house, and I'm very comfortable. But, you know, that's not the way the human mind works.
More light, the intriguing work of the psychic detective, here tomorrow at...
...some of Britpop and fizzy pop. You can see Spike Island Witness, and the man who held centre...